Hi friends, let us continue our discussion on the June 2018 question. Next question. The cell maintains a high concentration of protons inside the lysosome because of options are antiporter in the lysosomal membrane, ATP powered protein pump in the lysosomal membrane, facilitated diffusion proton channel in the lysosomal membrane, facilitated diffusion proton uniporter in the lysosomal membrane. Let's see more things about lysosomal membrane and lysosome. All of the lysosome enzymes are acid hydrolysis, which are active at acidic pH. About 5, they will be active. So the lysosome need to be maintained in acidic condition for the enzymes to work. The requirement of this lysosomal hydrolysis for acidic pH provides double protection against uncontrolled digestion of the contents of the cytosol. To maintain the lysosome inside acidic, the internal pH, lysosome must actively concentrate on H+ ions. This is accomplished by a proton pump in the lysosomal membrane, which is actively transporting protons into the lysosome from cytosol. This proton pump is involving in transporting protons from cytosol to the lysosome. The pump requires ATP hydrolysis for its function. So the answer will be the option number 2. Next question, E. coli takes 40 minutes to duplicate its genome during a bidirectional mode of replication. If E. coli were to use unidirectional mode of replication to synthesize a full copy of DNA complementary to just one of the strands of genome, it would take 40 minutes, 80 minutes, 20 minutes and 60 minutes. You can see that the difference between unidirectional and bidirectional replication in the figure. Figure A indicates the unidirectional replication in which replication fork continues only in one direction, while figure B indicates replication fork continues in two directions. So unidirectional one will be slower than the bidirectional one. E. coli doubles in 20 minutes while the replication take place about 40 minutes as it's indicated in the question. How it occurs? E. coli divides faster than its replication because as E. coli go through one replication session, as it about to complete, it start another replication at the origin of replication. That is the but during this session another replication was running, which was started earlier than beginning of the next replication. Replication of the DNA will start for the next cell, it will start before the first replication got completed. So that E. coli can double in 20 minutes. Here, coming to again to the question, whether the replication is unidirectional or bidirectional. Unidirectional, which take more time as the replication for continues only in one direction. Bidirectional, both sides the replication for continues, so it will take lesser time. So the question indicates that the replication involves single stranded replication only. If the replication is single stranded or double stranded, double the time will be needed for the unidirectional replication. For unidirectional replication, double the time will be needed than bidirectional replication. So for bidirectional application, the time will be 40 minutes. The answer will be option 2, that is the 80 minutes. Next question. Fertilization in sea urchin eggs involve Ca2+ released from the endoplasmic reticulum. for cortical granulary activation. The major molecule responsible for releasing of Ca2 plus ions from the intracellular stores are the options are sonapelizida glycoprotein, protamines, inositol 145 triphosphate, and acetyl glucosaminidase. Coming to the sea urchin fertilization, fertilization induces Ca2 plus release in the sea urchin eggs. The fusion of sea urchin sperm with the egg generates a transient NADP induced cortical flash of Ca2 plus influx, mark the beginning of the egg activation process. The main Ca2 plus wave at fertilization is due to the Ca2 plus release from the egg's internal stores in response to 3 Ca2 plus mobilizing messengers, IP3, CADPR and NADP. That these three messengers, in response to these three messengers, only the Ca2 plus is got released during fertilization. So the option 3, that is the inositol phosphate, IP3, is the correct answer. Next question. Melanopsin is found in which cell of retina? Cones, rods, ganglion cells, bipolar cells. Knowing more about melanopsin, melanopsins are a type of photopigment belonging to large family of light sensitive retinal protein called opsins, encoded by the gene OPN4 in mammalian retina. In addition to this melanopsin, there are two additional opsins which you may be familiar with, that is rhodopsin and photopsin, present in rod and cone photoreceptor cells. In human, the melanopsin is found in intrinsically photosensitive retinal ganglion cells. So the option 3, ganglion cells, will be the correct answer. It is also present in the iris of mice and primates. It's also present in rats, ampyxios and chordates. So the answer, option 3, ganglion cells, will be the correct answer. In rods or cones, rhodopsin and photopsin are the pigments present. Next question. Which of the following groups represents SAR clad of protists? Euglenosomes, red algae, parabasilids, brown algae, forams, radiolarians, slime molds, entamoebas, diplomodas, charophytes, coanoflagellates, tumblinids, etc. The answer is option number 2, that is the brown algae, forams and radiolarians. The brown algae, which belongs to the sarclade, staminophiles, usually they are marine seaweeds, forms large forests, many exhibit alteration of generation, having both haploid and diploid stages, can be isomorphic or heteromorphic. The example for brown algae including kelp and sargassum. Rhizaria is another group belongs to the sarclade. In rhizaria, contains the forams, radiolarians and sarcozoans, all belongs to the sarclade. Rest of the questions will be discussed in the next video. Stay tuned for the next video. Thank you for watching this video. Please subscribe to this channel. Please take your admission for TABR classes as soon as possible this week itself. TABR is located at Cochin, Edappally, near Lulu Mall. Thank you for viewing this video. Thank you.